Let's move on to the next half session. So the problem, Miklos described the problem last year, maybe give the mic to you. David also talked about how to monitor a very large number of mounts in a mount namespace. When mounts go away and mounts are created, how to mount monitor this efficiently. I don't know, I will let you guys continue this session. It's not mine, but I just want to say that like iNotify already has an unmount event, and there were requests to add this event to FANotify, and simply placing a watch on a mount and asking for an event when it is unmounted is very, very trivial. I mean, I posted a patch for that. That's very trivial. The question is, the two questions are, can this unmount event be used to provide efficient monitoring on a large number of mounts? And can we just generate a mount event for the other side? And if we do generate a mount event, what entity are we going to place the watch on? On the mount namespace, on the user namespace? There was another idea we talked about. We can place, technically, we can place a mark on the entity, on the entity that is a mount. Anything
like,
that's getting mounted.
Like on the mount point, yeah.
No, no, anything, you place a mark on a mount, anything gets mounted on top of that mount, you get an event for.
Ah, I see.
You can just place mount on all the head mounts and it's a recursive watch.
You know, I have done an implementation of this and basically you just, the way I did it, you just watch the namespace and put a path filter on it. It's kind of like how Windows does it, because everything is addressed. There are no hard links. You don't need to consider hard link type things. So a path is almost an exact descriptive amount, except that paths, you can have mounts, multiple mounts with the same path. So I just said, you put a watch there, you say everything under this path, and then anything that happens under that path, you get a notification for, or mount or unmount.
So yes, basically a mount tree is what you need to watch, yes.
Yeah, but you place it on a namespace, or on your namespace, you don't actually, the path is just a filter.
So each namespace has a separate mount tree, even though they share the directory trees. So I guess it's just, so it's slightly different watching mounts, because then you need to have information about which mount changed. So you need to have the mount ID, for example. But the problem with the mount ID is that mount IDs are reused whenever a mount is...
So I added an extra 64-bit mount ID that, it will eventually get reused. Your computer will probably dissolve first.
When you say added, it means RFC patches? Or?
Well, yeah, I've posted patches for it. It works.
Yeah, but your patches are not for FANotify, but for WatchQ. So it's the same concept, but with a different interface.
Well, it produces notification. We could make notifications come out somewhere else.
The problem really also was that it lumped a lot of stuff together.
I think the notification stuff and the, for example, the FS info stuff should have been decoupled in that patch set. And in your patch set, it was like one big thing, right?
The problem is that the notification queue has a limit, and you can overrun the limit. So if you move a whole mount tree, or if a whole load of people do mounts, it will generate a notification for each of them. And if you're not quick enough, the notification queue in the kernel will overrun. So
I don't think we need like a ring type of efficiency for this use case. So FN notifiers, I think, is less limited in that perspective.
Well, it still has a limit.
Yeah.
And if you overrun the limit, you then have to find some way to find all the.
So with FN notify, you can have two types of queues. One is in principle like unlimited, but obviously there is, and then it means basically the allocation will block until it can succeed. So basically you will fail them. You will block the mount until you can generate the notification essentially. So then you cannot lose events. That's one way how you can set up FN notify. The other one is that you will simply drop the event if you cannot accommodate it because the queue is already full, and then you you generate a special type of event like there is lost information.
Yes, the reason I added the FS info thing was so that you had a faster way of finding out what had changed, because otherwise you end up parsing proc of amounts.
So we,
which is slow.
We also have the eventual user of this API here. I made him come along, and. How performance sensitive is this actually for you?
I don't know. Like right now, we pass proc self mount info, and that of course is terrible. But for me, like you know, if events are dropped, that's fine as long as we have a way to figure out what happened in the meantime later, right? So we want an event that tells us very clearly the way events dropped, and we want an API that gives us this information on our own terms afterwards, which is better than proc self mount info. So I'm actually, but I mean, Amir knows this, I guess. I'm actually very much important having an API that tells me for a mount all the children of that specific mount, the immediate children of that specific mount, and gives me the events when immediate children come and go. That's all what I'm probably really would like to have in systemd.
Yeah, that's what I added in FS info. Ian Kent, don't think he's here, actually implemented a thing for systemd to use FS info, and apparently performed quite a bit better.
But yeah, I mean, I'm totally on board if we get a new API. Right now, it's really horrible what we have to do because, you know, in large Kubernetes installations, we get like these millions of events and we can't cope up, and we're just busy with dealing with that stuff.
Does it matter if it's Fnotify?
I don't really care. I mean, to me, it would be natural if Fnotify sounds great to me because it has the queue handling already and things like that, so. I'm reinventing. I don't know. I've never looked at what's your thing called again? The watch queue. I don't know. Like, what does it have for content? Like, you know what I like about FN notify? I think it can even coalesce events, right? Like, can it not so that it drops?
Which events?
Like, it can coalesce events subtree wise. Can it not do that? I don't know. I think this was discussed.
Events.
Yeah. So basically, that if it drops events somewhere, that instead of replacing them by a single bit of information that tells me that some information was lost, it would rather replace a couple of these events with a new event that just tells me below the subtree something got lost.
It doesn't have that. It only coalesces events with exact same information or very, very similar information. But for example, you could do something like that. If you're watching, I mean, it's pretty equivalent to watch a namespace and to recursively watch the direct children of a mount. I mean, you can sort of do one with the other. For FN notify, if we'd have to do like mount events for direct children, it would be pretty simple. Because one, at least limitation of the current API, it needs to get a path as the descriptor of the object. So it's easy to give a path describing a mount or a file system or an inode. But if you're watching in mount namespace, maybe it's hidden. Maybe it doesn't have a path yet, so there are complications. But if you're watching direct children, you can always set up a watch. Let me know if something is mounted on top of that mount. It's pretty easy. And then what information you get in the event, that could be configurable. So maybe you'd get the inode where it was mounted or other things. Or maybe you get nothing.
So
you just get an event, something was mounted. And this will be coalesced. multiple events of something was mounted.
What I would like to have is an OPATH file descriptor, simply as part of the event, like of the child.
You have an OPATH file FD or NFS file handle where you can get it, but of what? Of the mount point?
Of the mount point, yeah.
Yeah, you can get it or not get it, and then it's easier to call as many events. And then you get, so something has happened to the direct children, and then you only go and probe what happened. That's like...
I may have a silly question, but what's the actual use case for this? I mean, what are you guys intending to do with this info?
Like, in systemd, currently, like, the boot up process to a large degree is starting services and waiting until things happen, starting the next services, and a good part of that is setting up mounts. We can do stuff like, we start that service during late boot once /var MySQL or something has been mounted, and so we need these notifications. And this is actually, like, we use it heavily for individual services, and people use it heavily, like they run app so-and-so, and then immediately before starting app so-and-so, they mount something, and then it gets, because it's a dependency tree, it gets pulled in until that service, at the point the service runs, and then when the service dies, it gets automatically removed, unless somebody else also has a dependency and things like that. So for that, we need to track exactly what's going on in the system. And right now we do that always proxf mount info, and it's just terrible.
I don't know how I will describe the event of tact mount.
I'm not allowed to call it that anymore.
Why?
I was instructed to call it beneath. By friendly people on social media who pointed out that this has also other meanings that I wasn't aware of, and also for the danger of mistyping.
As I said to some people before, IOU ring was merged.
By the way, explain why I think that having this per mount point would be really nice, right? Like, so that we can watch the immediate child mount points instead of having something system-wide, is mostly because we generally in systemd want to only watch a subset of the entire tree, right? And because, like, things that show up in below /sys, we generally do not care about. They are API file systems. We never wait for them. They're just there, basically. And that's why, if we had the system-wide stuff, like proxf mount info, we mostly ignore events we get from there. So for me, it would be much, like, the thing that I find nice about the recursive thing is that even though it would be a little bit more work to manage for us, we could very specifically select the subtrees that we care about and ignore the subtrees we don't.
Yeah, but that brings us back to the iNotify recursive watch, which is racy, and we need to see that we can implement that without races. Like, when a child one is created, you need to automatically add a watch or something like that.
Yeah, the problem is that, yeah, if you are watching just whether something gets mounted under this mount, yeah, then so you learn something gets mounted, but then you have to place the watch on the
but
new thing.
Yeah, but that's fine with me. Like, I would just consider that I lost a mount event. Like, what I have to handle anyway if the queue runs over, right? It's not different than the queue runs over event.
Yeah, but you would have to do a scan of proc mount info.
Yeah, I don't want that. Like, I mean, that's a thing. Like, I definitely always want the ability that, yeah, I want the notifications and an API that gives me the immediate children. So that I always can catch up nicely, and an API for getting the immediate children, I don't know, maybe that's FS info, but that is kind of for me the other side of the medal. Like, having just FA notify without an API to get the immediate amounts of the children would be,
you mean,
not useless, but certainly not.
You get a notification for a mount event happening, or a U-mount event happening, and then you could pass this FD that you, for example, get to some sort of system call or whatever, in what form, and that gives you the list of child mounts,
yeah,
identified by what. So that's the thing, I think, and I think you wrote this on the list. I think we need a unique mount ID.
So yes, so mount is created. I guess the notification needs to contain the new the ID of the new mount. That's I'm not sure how it could be solved to make this how to solve the problem of adding the new notifications on the new mount.
Yeah, that's actually more that can be more complicated than you think, because if someone mounts and immediately mounts over the top of it, you can't get to the mount underneath unless you can address them by mount ID rather than path.
So for the system to use case, I don't care, because we only care about the topmost mounts.
I mean, if you... Ah, okay, I see what you mean. Yeah, if you have the mount ID, we need a way to query by a mount ID, but it shouldn't be... I mean, it shouldn't be a problem. No, I think the problem is... currently, the way it at least works for mounts is if you have an FD, that FD will refer to a dentry mount pair, right? So, and it will be fixed. That struct path usually doesn't change. But as soon as you enter into the mount system call world, the first thing that we do is lock mount, and then we walk up from that struct path to the topmost mount. So your FD technically refers to something else by the time, or can refer to something else by the time the actual mount operation is performed. If you have mounts on top of it.
I mean, what I would ideally want is a file descriptor to the mount FD, right? Like, so that it is clear what it is.
At some point, though Christian may beat me to it, I want to make it so that you can stick something to intercept mount calls that are being made, do something with them. Without network being enabled on the system.
To that point, even though it's a deviation, we're giving a presentation tomorrow, or not, Leonard mostly, how to do unprivileged mounting right now. But it would be nice if we had something like this. But upcalls for user space are a giant pain. And usually not something that we, stuff like user mode helper or also the keyring stuff, is pretty unusable.
Christian is absolutely right. User mode helpers need to die. They're terrible. They bypass the init system, so they don't get security stuff applied. They don't get resource management applied, and they live in their own environment, their own secret.
Are you staying for the security summit? Because there's some people who disagree with you there.
I'm staying around there, yeah. But I mean, it's like I know a lot of people who agree with me too on this, but yeah, it's just terrible because they don't have security settings at all, right? Like they don't inherit anything from anywhere. So
fuse.
What's fuse?
Of course. That up calls in that sense, yes.
Anyway, that's a different discussion. It's one of my personal things that I really want to see them go.
So I just want to double check. So the thing I was saying with about OPath is, okay, sure. You if you were to try to mount on top of it, then you would get some other behavior, but like that's just part and parcel of how mount works with everything. But like if the idea is that you want to get the set of child mounts or something like that, or you want to do some FS info or whatever that ends up being, effectively some way of like, oh, I have a thing, please give me the info about this particular mount or this particular FD, that presumably would not be translated because it wouldn't make sense to translate it in that case. Or would it have to be translated? Is it like a
no,
feature
it wouldn't,
of...
It wouldn't have to be, no.
Okay. So it's just like if you wanted to, I guess, U-mount or a-mount.
If
that
you
was
wanted
case,
to U-mount or U-mount and unmount, because, for example, mount property changing code also doesn't look up the topmost mount usually. So it's just really adding or removing.
Yeah, then you go
mount
through the whole mount tree and everything else.
And it makes sense. It makes sense because of at least the times that I had to be in this code is like if you were to try and U mount in the middle of a mount tree, you had all sorts of issue because you would need to reparent mounts and so on. And what mounts survive, and it's pretty messy to do cleanly.
The reason I was
the way propagation works, where your propagation starts from the parent mount that you're trying to unmount.
Yeah. So the reason I'm bringing the OPAR thing up is because if the issue is, we're talking about having mount IDs, which we hope won't overflow, but may or may not at some indeterminate point in the future of a system that's been up for 35 years or something, right? Because even if you have 64-bit whatever mount ID. The thing is that if you use like KCMP or whatever, if you had KCMP, you'd be able to compare two file descriptors. System D would have to open like 5,000 files for this to work, but like you would be able to check it that way, right? To check if the two things are the same, right?
Have a 64-bit number and you bump it every nanosecond, you will only overflow it in about 500 years. So I don't think you're any.
Yeah, sorry. It is a 64-bit number. Yeah. Sorry. No, you're right. Yeah, you're right. Sorry. So yeah. My bad.
We're never going to overflow in that 64-bit.
64-bit all the way.
Current mount IDs are a problem because they're not even allocated. Like pits are cyclically, but it's if you do mount dash dash bind opt and you get 364 and you umount and you mount immediately again, you get the same ID in case no one in another namespace but beat you to allocating that ID.
Can't you just extend them to 64-bit? I mean, they're not exposed in binary to user space, so you can just.
But then you'd suddenly have 64-bit numbers in proc self mount info.
So what?
Possibly.
Yeah, that doesn't seem like
but that sounds
regression, but it is exposed in name to handle at right. Actually. Maybe we can get around this. I'd propose that we have another at flag to get the MNT ID.
I take back my idea.
You know someone somewhere knows it's a 32-bit value, so it's usually
a 2. Yeah, forget it. It's a bad idea.
It's not. What am I supposed to do with that info? The mount ID is exposed in the system call. There's a system call argument even, right? Yes. And opened by handle at. Yeah, but what honestly, open by handle at 2, whatever. I mean, or an add flag, but I mean, it's not that we're. I think in terms of adding new system calls, it's much easier.
Honestly, I take back my thing because, I mean, for example, in system we parse that and we know it's an int, so we parse it as an int, so you cannot, like, the stupid idea of my ignore me. You have to have something different because otherwise you will break user space even if you exported it as a text file because we actually looked into the kernel to see what it's used internally and then we used the same type and that probably might have been a mistake, but.
That's one of the reasons I added a new value that was independent of the old one, because the old one is recycled, too small, people assume it's too small.
Honestly, you should just all use UUIDs and the problem goes away entirely. I'm serious.
Is that the reason why you put MNT ID 64-bit in statics, but then it returns the old one? Yeah, but statics returns 64 value, but it returns the old small value, so it's.
I made it 32-bit, and Linda said I had to make it 64-bit.
So. Add flag. Okay. We can have coffee. Okay. Thank you.